And so I have X, a Y, and a Z there. I also have an A and B, which are more basic, just intervallic elements. And so that's what is referenced in the chart that you see. It just talks about the different motives that are being combined and developed. The main thing is just to keep in mind that that's the, you know, the basic idea, that this is extremely motivic. So a couple more things. One thing just to mention is that these two clarinet sonatas were written at the very end of Brahms' life. So this is 3 years before he died. And they were written for a clarinetist friend. His name was Richard Mulfeld. So I was very fortunate that he met Richard Mulfeld, who's this fantastic virtuoso clarinetist. Since this inspired these two great works, which are such important works for the instrument. So let me give you a copy of this score. And so the way that the A theme was presented, this is written for B flat clarinet, and so it's written a step higher, so the clarinet part is in F major. And concert pitch is a step lower. So this opening idea that's presented in the clarinet is then developed in measure 11 in the bass. And so that is that opening X idea. And the second half of the first measure of the clarinet theme is the Y idea. At letter A, at measure 15 at the bottom of the page, that is that Y idea in diminution. And if you turn over to the next page, there's a quick modulation of letter B is the B theme in B flat major. And this is the passage where you have the clarinet and the left hand of the piano in a canon. But the left hand of the piano is just one beat behind. So you can follow along there to see that you have that, you know, for six measures. And so it's full of, you know, just these motivic connections. What happens at the bottom of that page, at the end of the exposition, is that it modulates back to E flat major. And then the development section begins at measure 56 on the following page. At that point, then the piano states the A theme in E flat. So it's similar to what Beethoven did in 59 number 1, you know, that the development starts back in tonic with a restatement of the A theme. So it kind of sounds like, you know, you have a repeat. But then it goes on. So the idea that's associated with the B theme is an octave leap. So if you go back to letter B, you'll see how it starts off with that octave, you know, leap. And so that is an element that will be discussed. So that's what the beginning development is working with there at measure 60. Then you're going to have a lot of interplay between the clarinet and the piano, and you'll have situations where the clarinet will begin a phrase and then the piano will conclude it. So they kind of, you know, handing themes back and forth. An example of that is at letter F, and the clarinet has an ascending arpeggiated harmony, and the piano answers it and finishes that phrase with a descending arpeggiated harmony. And so that interlocking, kind of, you know, weaving together, makes this real tight-knit construction and texture. Measure 65 is developing the B theme with the octave leap. And this development section is just all about working with those motives that you saw in the exposition. So it's really very tightly knit and, you know, has an intellectual component to it. So the recap occurs at 1:03. And it's a little more animated. Now you have triplet eighth notes in the piano part. That's not unusual to embellish things as when it returns. The B theme is at letter I, but it comes back in the wrong key. So it starts off in C flat major, but then it makes its way to the expected key of tonic at 126. And then the rest of the recap is just like the exposition, so there's nothing that's really different. When you get to the coda, that's the last measure of page 133, then that slips up a half step to E major. It's a very beautiful moment. It's actually, if you, you know, are analyzing this, you know, theoretically, it's an inharmonic spelling of the Neapolitan key. So in E flat major, F flat is the Neapolitan key. And so, but he writes in E major because it's easier to read than F flat. And it's, then it's back to E flat at measure 161. So that's one of those moments where you kind of, you know, slips back down a half step. All right, let's listen to this. C-flat. Scherzo trio movement. So, first movement was Sonata Allegro. Second movement is in the key of E flat minor, so it's in the parallel minor key. So scherzo trio form. If you listen to the last movement, which isn't on your listening list, but it's a set of theme and variations. There's six variations in the last movement. So this is just a real typical, you know, classical use of forms. And so in the second movement, we'll pass those scores across, I'll trade with you. Thank you. flat minor, Allegro appassionato. So great. Very emotional, very intense.